where Arnold gets up and down. Welcome to Wired and Witty's podcast.
Welcome to our Wired
and Witty
and everything else podcast, where we are going to bullshit about bullshit, as usual. Yeah, I was trying to think of something else to say, but that's usually what we do here. As usual, since the start of our new year, we've been shouting out to other YouTube channels. And Sasha, who do we got this week?
Oh, well, we got a good friend, and it's probably obvious, you know, since, you know, if you guys are friends with us on Twitter, Jen Marie.
Yay!
Hey, Jen.
Yay, she recently actually did some artwork for us.
Yeah.
That turned out amazing.
Yeah,
oh my god.
It really did.
And we went and watched a video last night for it. And oh my god, she like put so much detail. Like we were even thinking like, "Oh, look at that. She looks like she's almost done." And then like, nope, she adds like a whole bunch more to it. And hopefully we'll have her on if not a video game episode, definitely a podcast very soon.
Yeah.
Kind of do like a little interview with her. And I mean, she just recently created her channel not too long ago, right?
She did. She had a channel before that, like way back then.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, she created about, I want to say a month ago.
Okay.
And she has 419 subscribers already.
Shit, I think she was at like 404 last night.
Yeah, she was at 404 last night. Yeah.
Go, girl.
One of her videos has over 7,000 views. I mean, she's a really talented artist, and you guys should definitely check her out. She is a good friend of ours. We may be a little biased, but, you know, I ever since I've met Jen and I've seen her artwork, and she has plenty more to show than just what's on her channel. I mean, she's incredible, and she's really talented. And you guys should go show your love and support for her, because this is a big venture for her. This is, you know, the first time she's kind of put her stuff out there. She has a Tumblr that she's put stuff on, and I think she has over 4,000 followers on Tumblr.
Wow.
Yeah, for her artwork. So go check her out. You know, she's really into, you know, the... I guess it's kind of anime style, but it's like her own style. And she does a lot of speed paint videos, and she's looking to get into some other things. But, you know, she's really super into Perfume, which is it's a Japanese pop band, who are actually really good. I used to make fun of her for liking J-pop and K-pop. I used to. Right? And then she showed me the world of J and K-pop. And I'm not going to get into it because that's what I want to talk to her about on our next podcast.
Okay.
But not next podcast, because next podcast is Super Bowl, but it's coming. So, you know, if you guys are a fan of hers, and if you're, you know, just seeing her for the first time, you know, definitely show your love. You know, go in her channel and support her. She's a great person.
Yeah, we'll put a link in the description below, and just make sure you go check out some of her videos. Obviously, if you like them, drop a like and subscribe to our Wired or Witty sent you.
Yeah.
But yeah, I can't like it looks amazing.
Yeah, it does. She really did a good job, and she did it in like 2 days.
Yeah, which is crazy. Because I remember like Sasha sent me this sketch. I think it was like on a Monday.
Mm-hmm.
It was like, here, look, check this out, and it was like literally just a rough draft of it. I was like, oh, that's great. So I'm thinking like, you know, maybe 3 weeks to a month from now, we'll actually see the finished product. And like, it was what, Thursday you're sending me like the final thing?
The final,
like, whoa! And it looks good. It looks really good.
Yeah,
I even like the attention to detail. She added
incredible.
The light bar to the PlayStation.
Yeah, and like the glow from the TV. It's great. And you know, she did us as a Jet and Spike from Cowboy Bebop. So if you guys are a fan, we're gonna put a picture up here, and of course you can go on Twitter. It's now our banner. Jen Marie. Just type her name into, she has her own channel name, so she has her own customized link, so just type in Jen Marie, and that's JenMarii, so double I.
Yeah. Thanks again, Jen. It looks great.
Yeah, thank you.
And good luck with all that. All right, so moving on to our next thing. I guess you kind of already mentioned a Super Bowl. The Atlanta Falcons and the New England Patriots will be playing in Houston for the Super Bowl. I'm not like, it's not like I dislike Atlanta by any means, but I'll definitely be rooting for them because I'm just not a Patriots fan. Mm-hmm. And one day I'll explain my story as to why I'm not a Patriots fan. But and it's not just to hate. Okay, I guess I should explain it now. Would now be a good time? Why I dislike the Patriots? All right, so People can possibly understand that whenever you're actually like living in a city and a new sports team's created, it's easy to become a fan. For example, like we're in Orlando and we were around when the Orlando City Lions were created. I mean, I'm not a huge soccer fan, but definitely a cool team. Definitely I like the purple. I always root for them whenever they're playing, and I get a chance to watch it. It's a cool team, so it's easy to jump on. Well, I was living in Jacksonville when the same thing occurred with the Jaguars. So it was without question, I just instantly became a Jaguars fan. Mm-hmm. For no real good reason, and they were actually a really good team. I know, like, for the past few years, they've been really miserable, really crappy, but, you know, it's still not going to deter me from being a really, really good fan. Because before that, I was, like, kind of a toss between, like, a Lions fan, and when the Houston Oilers were around, I was kind of a fan of them for a little bit, but then they went away. But I hate the Houston Texans. I don't know why. Anyways, so, you know, I'm a big Jaguars fan. They were in the championship. And everyone's like saying the Jaguars are going to play the Carolina Panthers for the Super Bowl. I was super stoked. And the Patriots happened to crush that. And not to say, like, you know, not to be a sore loser or anything like that, but that just stirred my dislike for the Patriots. That's where it started, anyways.
Yeah.
You know, and then from there, though, in my experience, there's no talking. Okay, not to put everybody in one box. To most Patriots fans, there's no reasoning with them or talking to them. Like, they are just, well, blindsided to just, nope, Patriots are the best team ever, they're going to always be, and they are a very good team. I'm not gonna doubt them that they're fucking, what, in the past like 7 years they've been to like Super Bowl like fucking what, four times or some crazy shit. I'm probably misquoting and fucking up my facts, but they've been to the Super Bowl a lot of times. Tom Brady's like one of the best quarterbacks the NFL's ever seen. There's no denying their success, and they're a really good team. But man, Patriots fans, again, not all of them are, and if you guys are Patriots fans, I'm sorry, I'm not trying to insult you, but man, like, there's a lot of Patriots fans I bump into that I'll just try to have like a reasonable conversation, and it's just Patriots. There's no talking to them, like, you know, hey man, Le'Veon Bell's a really good running back. Nope, he's no LeGarrette Blount. Nope. You know, it's like, there's no talking to them. Anyways, not to get too super sports on you, but that's my experience, and that's why I don't like the Patriots, and I will forever root against them. Mm-hmm. But I'm not going to sit there and say they're a shitty team, because they're obviously not.
No.
Anything else you want to add to the sports?
I don't know. Like, I was really hoping that Dallas would go through, because, you know, that'd be pretty awesome.
Yeah, Green Bay saw that.
Yeah.
But that was like the best playoff game. All the playoff games have sucked aside from that game. And I'll give some props to like the Pittsburgh Kansas City game. That was pretty good.
Oh, that was pretty good. Yeah.
But the rest of them were like blowouts. It was bad. I would have liked to see Dallas go, but at least they got a good team for next year.
Oh yeah, I'm thinking they're gonna really step back, look at what they have. I mean, Dak Prescott stepped up, and even though they're not in the Super Bowl, you have to give it to the guy.
Oh, hell yeah.
He carried that team.
And Ezekiel Elliott as well.
Dude, I mean, they have something really good there. And, you know, I think they're going to come back just as strong. And, you know, I'm a Tampa Bay fan. I'm not particularly a Cowboys fan. But, you know, I was really impressed with what I saw this season.
Yeah.
And, you know, I hope that, you know, next season, you know, it can be someone else in the Super Bowl. I mean, I don't mind the Patriots. I used Tom Brady in my fantasy. It got me undefeated the entire season.
Yeah, it did.
Like, I give him props, you know, but, you know, I just want to see someone else, you know? And
yeah.
Because it's pretty much like, if I know that they're going to be in the Super Bowl, unless something really weird happens, then I know they're pretty much going to win. It's going to be the same thing as last year.
When they went undefeated and Giants, they play against Giants, everyone's like, oh, Patriots got this. It's going to be a blowout, and Giants won.
Yeah, Giants won.
But, that made me laugh. I'm sorry. Yeah, it's going to be, hopefully, like you said, like the Cowboys come back again. I'm no Cowboys fan, but, I mean, it's been a long time coming since they've been a good football team.
Give some props for Tom Landry. You know, make him proud up in Cowboy heaven.
You know what? This week going to work, because the Pro Bowl's here in Florida.
Yeah.
I saw like a whole squad of like these football like semis that like Monday Night Football written on them. They were going towards Orlando. Awesome. They're probably going to set up the Pro Bowl. Like,
yeah.
I'm not going, but, you know, that's so really cool that they came to Orlando.
Yeah, I mean, I had a chance to get discount tickets. But man, it's still so fucking expensive. I'm like, yeah, you know, I'm not paying $300, but I'm still paying $200. I'm like, ugh.
Really? Yeah. I saw like some tickets going for it was about $45. But
yeah,
but
that's like up in the fucking. You're like saying you're like high fiving Jesus. Like, like, <I don't> wanna...
Yeah,
and then he goes down. He's like, "I got better seats."
It's not that I don't like the Pro Bowl and it's cool they were having it here, and I wish I would go, but I already have other obligations, so I can't go. So, moving on to sports ball from off of sports balls into video games, which I probably should have did before I was Super Bowl mine. The only thing I really uncovered this week, I mean, I see like a lot of new Ghostlands gameplay starting to come to, so they're definitely doing a lot to promote that game. It looks good. I'm definitely excited for it. Did you happen to see the Injustice 2 kind of reveal of like Robin?
Yeah, looks pretty good.
Yeah, how they're using the I think the what would it be? I think that's the fourth Robin. It's the one that's actually Bruce Wayne's son.
Yeah,
and how he's like was raised by like Ra's al Ghul, and he doesn't mind killing and shit like that. So, that looked really cool. And then the Resident Evil 7 reviews are starting to come in, and we've started playing it for our channel. I can't wait to play some more. And believe me, even though I was like, I'm gonna buy this game, I don't care. I still had that fear of like this game could potentially blow in the back of my mind. And so far from what I played and everywhere I've seen, it's getting outstanding reviews.
Yeah.
Obviously, some criticism here and there, but that goes without, everybody's going to criticize everything.
It's criticism that sort of makes sense. Like, good game, but a little bit gory. Like, a little bit more gory than, you know, people would think.
Right.
And Resident Evil is a gory game.
Yeah. But,
you know, we haven't seen real gore like this. I mean, we've seen it from Outlast, you know, so it's... I don't know, like, it scares me to fucking death, but I actually, when we're playing it for the channel, I actually am, like, really interested to see how it goes, and I know you've been, you know, jonesing to play it, and I find myself like, oh, yeah, I kind of want to see what happens, like, I want to find out what happens with her, and I want to see what all this is about.
Yeah.
And, you know, for someone who, like me, who has knows nothing about Resident Evil, I mean, I know Resident Evil 1, and I got to the white zombie, and I immediately was like, nope.
Well, you watch me play through 4, so you know a little bit about
I know through 4, and then some of 6, and, you know, I've slowly started to get an appreciation, but this is a huge step away from all of those.
Yeah.
You know, I'm still waiting for, like, you know, Jill Valentine to kick open that grudgy-ass door. Come with me. If you want to live. You know?
I don't know, maybe we'll see something like that. Maybe. Yeah, I've been actually avoiding playing the game, even as from a personal perspective. I've been avoiding all videos, any sort of spoiler risk. I don't want to be spoiled, and I don't want to play it on the side and then just go through the game for our channel. I've been waiting for Sasha. Obviously, we have different schedules, so I really want to be surprised. So I've refrained from playing the game personally. So, I've been, like you said, Jones in the fucking play. You're absolutely right. But we're definitely going to get a lot of videos. I'm sure I'm going to get my fill of Resident Evil here real soon. So, it'll be okay. What else you got for, like, anything video game related or otherwise? Yeah, go for it.
Square Enix entered a multi-game deal to bring Marvel games.
That's light. Amazing. That is really cool. Because, like, dude, Square Enix has done some really good things, like the Tomb Raider game of Square Enix. And, I mean, yeah, talk shit if you will, but the Hitman games aren't that bad.
No, they're not.
They're
not.
Definitely very talented. Obviously, you know, you got the Final Fantasies and things like that. But that's really cool. That's definitely big news. So I guess this was just acquired. So they're, like, probably not even in development of any sort of game, I would take it.
Not really. I mean, they were... Something had been started, I think, by Marvel, but that was canceled, even though it looked okay.
Mm-hmm.
I think they're really starting from, like, the ground up, because, you know, in the past, you know, you've got that Superman game, you've got the Spider-Man game, and, you know, you've got all those, like, you know, superhero games that don't do that well, that have, you know, and they have promise, they have maybe a story to them, because, of course, how can you not, but then they just end up being complete garbage, and then end up being notorious for being complete garbage, but they're going to get Crystal Dynamics to do it,
which That's is good.
The people that did the Tomb Raider series.
That's really good.
So, I think it's going to be really good.
I mean, I kind of like the Ultimate Alliance games. They're okay. I mean, they get a little boring to me after a while, but they're not a bad start. But when you compare that to, like, Arkham Asylum and City and Injustice and all the, like, because that's the thing, like, DC knows how to make, or, well, the Warner Brothers, whatever, that make the DC mm-hmm. games, know how to make a really good fucking game.
Oh, and, yeah, the Rocksteady.
Yeah, oh, yeah, Rocksteady. Yeah, Rocksteady. Oh, man. Really yeah, they so do a really good. Job. So good. And then you really, like, look at, well, okay, what does Marvel have to offer? They're not a lot when it comes to video game market right now, but their movies are really kick-ass. I love yeah. all their movies, yeah. and they definitely are in need of a good company to make some really fucking awesome video games for them. I could imagine, like, seeing out the Avengers, I've noticed that with Marvel games is that sometimes they cram a lot of heroes in one. Not to say it's bad. Mm-hmm. It's just they all start to play similarly or alike.
Yeah.
Versus, like, you know, DC, like, they got Batman-specific ones. So mm-hmm. we'll see. I'm hoping it's really good. I mean, obviously, it just started, so it'll be years before we see it, but most likely, or at least a teaser or
yeah, a teaser's been released. I mean, a cinematic one, but I mean, it gets people clumped. And
oh yeah,
you know, in the meantime, that Spider-Man game is coming out
yes.
soon, and hopefully it's exclusively to the PlayStation 4.
Fuck yeah! Hopefully, so, it's
and
good.
That one looks good. I don't care what the suit looks like. You can go fuck yourself.
Oh yeah, I don't give a shit about the suit. I want it to be fun, like, and if it's fun,
it looks pretty fucking fun. Yeah, okay. And I hope the story is just as good, but. It looks like it's gonna be a good game. I would be surprised if it let anyone down. Yeah.
Yeah. No. Definitely. That's really good news. I can't wait to see what Square Enix says, because like I said, I can't think of a bad game in recent years, anyways, that it was like Square Enix has made and been like, that's dog shit. I can't think of one. I don't know.
I'm sure there is, but.
I mean, I know like the was it the Final Fantasy, the new Final Fantasy, like either you love it or hate it sort of game.
Yeah, I mean, it takes 3 days to 3 real-time days to beat a boss. Either that seriously appeals to you, or that is just like, what the fuck?
Yeah, I don't think it's a required boss, but yeah, it's like one of the hidden ones. But even then, it's like, are you serious?
Yeah, but that's how, you know, that's how those Final Fantasy games are. If you're a true diehard fan, you'll do it, dude.
That's true.
You'll fucking do it.
That's true. There's rumors, again, this is just rumor mill, that that the Kingdom Hearts may or may not be including, like, a Marvel zone.
I know. Didn't the prologue come out today? Or yesterday, a couple of days ago? 2.5 or 2.8?
I think it came out, yeah, because it was coming out this month, so it should be out, if not very soon, yeah.
Yeah. 2.8, the final chapter prologue, whatever that means. But I'm not a huge Kingdom Hearts fan. But I've watched, you know, a couple of playthroughs with my friends, and it looks fun. Yeah. I don't want to play it, but you know, it looks fun. It's fun for me to watch. And I know that the new one has been a long time coming.
Yeah.
And I know that when people get their hands on it, they're going to cry. Because it's been so fucking long.
Yeah, it is.
But I believe it's going to probably be worth the wait.
Mm-hmm. It would be so cool if they, like, incorporated, like, a little Star Wars world in it, as well as a little Marvel world. That'd be so cool. They have the licenses for it. Yeah, Let's do it.
I mean, it's pretty much open to... Oh, God, you know, that game could make so much money with the amount of, you know, just flexibility they have with licenses. You know, it's Disney.
Yeah.
So, I think it got like a 7 out of 10, you know, so it seems to be the range.
Yeah.
The final chapter prologue, but if you guys haven't checked it out, pick it up. It's supposed to be a good game.
Yep, definitely. No, I just don't know why, not to shit on them or anything like that, but they like, okay, so the first Kingdom Hearts came out, then, like, I think it was shortly after that, it was, like, somewhere around then and then thereafter the second, they just started releasing a bunch of, like, mobile games and other things. And the sad thing is, apparently the mobile games, which I only played, like, very few of, added to the story here and there. But, like, they just, like, almost seem to, like, release them in rapid-fire fashion. Almost seem like every time you turn around, a new Kingdom Hearts, you know, weird name, insert here, 365/2, you know, this and that. Sorry, coming out, I don't think that was a good idea, per se, from my perspective, but that's just me. I mean, I would much rather them focus on, like, actual numbered series for potential, like, hardcore console players. Not to say don't release handheld things. I would just more like, if you're going to do like a handheld title with it, my recommendation for that is just do like a side story to where you're not really missing anything if you don't play it. But if you do play it, you're going to like know what happened to this side character per se. And yeah, it'll be a cool little enjoyable side story. To me, that would have been a smarter way to do it. But again, I'm no like you, like I've played the couple of the Kingdom Hearts. I haven't beat the second one. But I beat the first one. I even was like back in the day, man, I like completed like the Sephiroth boss and I had a lot of fun with it. It was a great game. But then, like I said, all of a sudden I was getting pelted in the face by all these like GBA game and a freaking DS games everywhere. And like, it was just, where's all these Kingdom Hearts games doing? I don't know.
I think it was, you know, I think they expected it to be a success, but they didn't expect it to be as a big of a success as it was. And, you know, they have a really strong fan base.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think what they were trying to do is like, okay, you know, if we're going to go into serious development with another one, what are we going to have them do in the meantime to keep interest? So, you know, they release all these handhelds, do all this, you know, release, maybe, you know, yeah, you know, chapters, blah, 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 through this. And it has kept, you know, the serious fans interested, because, you know, it's just leading towards the next one, and they know, like, this is it. This is I'm going to get it soon. So, you know, it's
such a cool idea, too, that Mitch makes such, like, two odd things. I'm surprised other companies / game developers haven't tried partnering with other things to try to make, like, a little clashed world at it. I love when things collide like that. That's why, like, one reason I was attracted to like Marvel vs. Capcom.
Oh, yeah.
It's so two different things and kind of zany almost and fun. And even like the Mortal Kombat versus DC. I mean, yeah, it's not the greatest game in the world, I will agree, but you can't deny it was actually kind of fun and enjoyable seeing like Scorpion and Joker fight. You know,
yeah,
like, I love when things kind of clash up like that, as long as it doesn't suck. And, like, you know, your Final Fantasy characters and Square Enix characters meet, like, Disney characters.
Oh, yeah.
It was such so crazy. I was like, one moment I remember when I was fighting one of the secret bosses, Sephiroth, I was like, who the fuck thought, man, Goofy and Donald Duck would be fighting Sephiroth? Like, it's like all of a sudden, like, that's so, it's so crazy. It's cool. I don't know. Cool. Yeah, I can't wait for it. I see something Star Wars related on here.
Well, of course. I mean, everyone who's anyone
the last
saw the teaser. Well, not even a teaser. It's like the picture on the screenshot of Star Wars: The Last Jedi, and I got like a text like a couple of days ago when it was first released from Cassie, and it was just like a text of. Like, I can't wait for December, and I'm like, it is January. Like, I'm a huge Star Wars fan, but I can't be on edge up until you know, for an entire year. Like, I'm gonna calm down and I'm gonna wait, but you know, this is what they do to you. You know, they release little tidbits, and they, you know, you get to see like they released like a picture of the crawl. And you know, you're looking at, and it's only, all it says is, you know, The Last Jedi. And immediately I'm just like, ah! And you know, if you're not a Super Bowl fan, you know, that's completely fine. If you're not a football fan, that's completely fine. But the first teaser could possibly occur during the Super Bowl, so
ooh,
you know that you're
going to
be sitting there watching that 5-hour game. For
that is true.
Yeah,
and at the same time, they have to spend a lot of money on those commercials
which
is crazy. But yeah. I mean, Star Wars is obviously, there's no denying, a monster franchise, and obviously they got to do things like this to keep interest, which is smart,
very
good marketing, you know, little teasers here and there is all you really need. Yeah, I love things whenever they get, like, they're getting hyper teasers or new trailers, new gameplay, like the Injustice 2 gets me all excited. Mm-hmm. But I seriously can't wait for the first AAA company to keep such a tight lid on a new video game to where they're like presenting it at E3 and then saying, you like that? Isn't that cool? And then being like, it's coming out next week, or like, it's coming out next month, or just like, it's like
look
right around
the
corner. everyone would lose their shit, because like most of the time you get these gameplay things and then it'll be 6 months to a year later, and most of the time too, you unfortunately get something completely different than what you initially saw. I mean
Watch Dogs.
Yeah, you know, Watch Dogs. Mm-hmm. Even I saw like the when they first showed Resident Evil 4. And it actually was like what they call like the fog edition. It was actually turned out to be something completely different than what was initially showed when they first showed off the game.
Yeah.
But yeah, regarding like movies, obviously you need to present that.
Yeah, but a little bit of hype, cute, because it's not coming out until December. So they're gonna start doing these little things like maybe showing like the side profile of Mark Hamill's hand holding a lightsaber oh so gently, and then everyone's like, "Bleh!"
yeah, definitely. It's gonna be a great movie, I'm sure. I can't wait for the next numbered franchise. I still gotta go out and see Rogue One, or at least
we gotta see that.
Yeah, so
I've seen it. And it's fucking you'd fucking love it. I mean,
I like the seventh one. I know a lot of people kind of gave it flack here and there, but I enjoyed it.
It's not that bad, but Rogue One is definitely better.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm gonna say that. And even though it has nothing to do with the seventh one, I mean, it does a little bit, but it's its own story. It's fucking fantastic. But it's hard to do that because you can't. It's especially when it comes to video games. To do the whole it's coming out like a week later, or it's coming out because everything gets spoiled. That's just.
Sucks.
Yeah, that's just how the video game pit is, and like that's specifically why when we do our thumbnails for our channel, we only put one picture, and we just change the numbering. We make our picture as vague as possible. We rarely ever change it. The only time I changed it was for Firewatch, and that was just different scenes because it was pretty. And
yeah, it didn't spoil anything.
Yeah, it didn't spoil anything.
And if you include thumbnail like spoilers or even descriptions, you're a dickhead.
Hate it.
You're a fucko.
So far as saying you're a dickhead. No, Markiplier is not a dickhead. I just, I don't want to know what's going on. Like, I don't want to know that, this character dies or, like, because even though I'm not a huge Resident Evil fan, I don't want to know what happens in the story because I'm actually interested in what happens. Like, this.
Yeah.
It scares the wee out of me, but I want to not be spoiled.
Well, that just goes with anything. I hate when, like, a picture or a description. Yeah. The description should say, like, want to know something that happens within this particular movie /
it can still be clickbaity that way.
Click ahead and then like have the whole like spoilers hashtag. That's the proper way to do it. Your thumbnail.
Yeah, stop, dude.
Your description should not contain a spoiler. That's a dick move.
There's one channel that does this in particular. I'm not going to say who, it spoiled it. Like, because I've been waiting for Watch Dogs and I've been waiting for it to price drop so that I can purchase it.
Mm-hmm.
And they have how they have that character, the hacker that has a mask over his face.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I now know what he looks like because of a fucking thumbnail. Aww. That shows up in my feed, and like, and that might seem like, okay, well, what's the big deal? But I didn't want to know. Like, just stop.
Yeah, no, that's a dick move. Which I hate people that post spoilers on social media. Obviously, I'm thankfully I'm not a lot of friends with people that do that. Mm-hmm. There's usually a grace period. I think for TV, it's usually at least like 3 or 4 days. Is usually about the threshold, and then with movies it's a good week and a half before you're allowed to post spoilers for that stuff, or at least some open discussion regarding it, which brings me to my Wired's Why the Fuck. You ready for this? It does bring me into it. Now either you're going to jump on my Why the Fuck rant and ride it into the sun with me, or you're gonna call me a complete dick. So yeah. We're gonna definitely see which side you agree. I think you're gonna agree with me though. I think you are.
Okay.
I'm sure we all have that at least one friend on social media that can't help themselves but to bitch, gripe, whine, and moan about everything, as well as just post these really negative. I'm at a loss for words right now. Things that is almost like stupid and almost borderline immature and childish to post, and things like that. So let me give you some context to throw it in. So for example, one person on my feed was complaining about losing their job, which sucks. I mean, again, that's very unfortunate, and was also at first asking for reasonable help to, you know, anybody that's hiring. That's good stuff to post on social media. All for it.
Of course.
But prior to this, would constantly bitch and gripe about customers, bitch and gripe about management, bitch and gripe about other coworkers, blatantly on social media, which is not smart. No. Because even though you're not friends with, let's say, Tom, your boss on there, you might be friends with Dan, who is.
Yeah.
And Dan kind of likes Tom, so Dan's going to go post things. Yo, Tom, look what Jerry's saying about you. Man, you know, and then Tom finds out, and then he's probably going to find a way to fire your ass, or at least, like, you know, I know who I'm not promoting, you know. Yeah. Or, oh, the raises are due soon. Well, guess who's not getting one? You know, it's just stupid posts like that. But then furthermore, the same individual goes to post things like, well, I found a job that's really close by, but they're not giving me the hours or pay I want. So, no. And I'm just like, okay, first off, why post on social media? Secondly, that's dumb. Because back when I was about this youthful, maybe even younger, actually. I mean, this person's like
you're old.
I know. Like, this person's like about 7 years younger than I am, which honestly is quite a bit. So, anyways. But back when I was like fucking 19, 20 years old, not to say I'm better than this person by any means, you know, I had two jobs, was going to college full time. So, you know, to basically, I know this particular person is not going to school, and to basically say, I'm not taking that job, it's beneath me, it's kind of dumb, because I even posted on there, I was like, why don't you just take the job, and then because you're not getting the hours you want, you obviously still have time to go look for other jobs, and even maybe have to hold two at once and juggle a little bit, and they basically said no. Which is dumb. I mean, I've had to do that, and, you know, when you're not quite happy with, you know, the amount of pay or work you're getting, you might have to balance too, or at least, you know, while you're, at least you're getting some income.
Right. I'd rather make no money than some money.
Yeah, that's just stupid. But then it goes further past that, you know, like other examples, and this isn't the same individual, just post these vague ass, like, you know, the world sucks sort of thing, or like, you know, today was just so hard, I think I'm going to end it. I mean, yeah, suicide's no joke, no laughing matter, and if you are thinking suicidal thoughts, you definitely need to seek help immediately. There's no shame in calling those 1-800, like, suicide hotlines, or even a relative and or close friend and saying, I really, really, really need somebody to talk about. But in the post I'm more referring to is just basically it comes across as, well, life's not fair. Give me attention. And that's never fun. Never cool to see on a Facebook feed, but also at the same time, it's just annoying as fuck in some cases. And then in my experience, when you try to reach out to some of these people, and I've tried in many different ways whenever these type of people make these type of comments of just like, hey, is everything okay? Or, hey, do you want to hang out later? Or, hey, do you want to call me and talk to me about this? I'll rarely, if never, receive a response back from these type of vague-ass give-me-attention responses. And it's just, you shouldn't be using social media for these type of bullshit things, in my opinion, because, I don't know, Sasha, well, first off, you're being obviously quiet. I don't know if you're agreeing or disagreeing with me. Let me hear your side.
No, I mean, I agree. Like, I get, you know, like, posting about, like, man, today was really tough. Like, I get that.
Yeah.
You know, like, sometimes, man, you just have a rough fucking day, and, you know, that's what, you know, mainly social media was for, was just, like, you know, giving you little, like, here's how my day went, or, like, you know, little tidbits, like, it's social, it's, you know, it's the equivalent to you texting, you know, your friend, you know, individually saying, I had a rough day today, and, but, you know, this way, you know, everyone will know that you had a rough day, and, you know, people can comment and offer support, like, I get that. You know, it's a great way to keep up with relatives. It's a great way to, you know, just be connected to people. But when it gets too far, like, I know that I agree with you. There's this, there's one particular person that comes to mind for me, that I'm, and she knows she does it for attention. I know that she does it for,
you know, they do.
Yeah. And it's like the only reason I'm friends with her and the only reason why my friends are friends with her on Facebook is because, you know, we constantly just see her posting all this shit and then we'll just like take a screenshot and send it to each other on group chat and be like, what the fuck? Like, what the fuck is she up to today? Like, what is she doing? But, you know, I just...
Also, like, I've blocked a lot of people like that from my Facebook feed. It takes a lot for me to actually go through and unfriend somebody unless they, like, did something really wrong or said something really wrong. And then, yeah, I'll go unfriend you because I don't want to be, you know, any sort of associated with you in any way. But usually I'll just block a lot of people like that from my feed where it's just, like, where it's constantly, like, does everything bad always happen to this person? Does anything good ever happen?
Yeah.
And it's, I know it's really easy to post negative and bad things, you know, Trump's bad and, you know, my job sucks. It's easy to get in the negative. And honestly, I think as a human species, we like that shit. It's, it stirs drama and conversation. But when that's all you're fucking posting, it gets fucking old and tiresome real quick. Especially when they're just fucking blatant ass whiny. This is whiny, like, help, you know, like, it's nothing to help themselves, it's nothing productive they're doing, they're just using it as a vent or an outlet, and not to say you shouldn't post adversities, I get it, and there's a right and wrong way to do it, you know, you had a death in a family, that shit's tough.
Yeah.
And that's, and I'm not saying you shouldn't post things like that, that's, it's, no. It's okay, but it's whenever you go about it in such a childish manner, it's just, it's, to me, I find it just a huge turnoff, and just annoying, and... especially if that's like, if you go through your Facebook feed and that's like all you post about is bitching about this and that, whether it be the guy at Starbucks fucked up my shit, this movie sucks, this video game is stupid, and, you know, sports balls is just fucking lame, and I don't know why people fucking watch football, and you know, that's like all you're doing is just fucking spitting on the world, essentially. Chances are, A, I'm either not friends with you, or B, I'm not even seeing these because they're already blocked from my Facebook feed. So, you know, there's people like that. And basically, though, to bring my segment to kind of a point is, if you are using social media as an outlet for these stupid-ass things, and especially like my particular individual that I'm referencing, which I'm sure is not even going to watch this. So I don't, and even if they did, I wouldn't care. They probably wouldn't even know I'm talking about them anyways.
Yeah, that's the sad part is that, you know, these people don't think they're doing anything that's particularly, and I wouldn't say annoying is a strong word, but that's the word I'm going to go with. They don't particularly see that, well, you know, I'm just posting about my life. I'm just, you know, I'm just letting it all out there. I don't like to keep things in. Like, I'm not asking you to keep it in. I'm just asking you to dial it back a bit.
Yeah, and also if it's really that bothersome, why don't you...
Do something about it!
Well, do something about it. And if you need to talk about it, why don't you, like, pick up a phone and actually call somebody or go over to your friend's house? Or, hell, like, why don't you just fucking, you know, pick up your nearest pet, and if you don't have one, go adopt one and express your concerns to the world about them, because they're just going to sit there and listen to you and be like, cookies?
Yeah,
so,
I love you. Yeah, that's the best thing about pets. They love you no matter what, even if you're a whiny bitch. Even like, if they love you no matter what.
And they'll listen, you know. I think you even, I hear you sometimes talk to Kato about stupid shit.
And yeah, he just, you know, kisses my nose. He's like, I love you, Mom. Like, I love you, too. And then, like, I used to be like that. I'm still an extremely negative person. I'm a pessimist at heart. But, you know, I do something. You know, like, when I lost my job last year, I was basically a human amoeba. And, like, just sitting around the house, smoking cigarettes, like, smoking a whole pack a day, just, like, feeling sorry for myself. I mean, I didn't go on Facebook and announce it to everybody, mainly because, like, you know, I don't want people to feel pity for me. And I'm friends with most of the people that I worked with at the time. But, you know, I found doing a YouTube channel. Like, I found doing that as a creative outlet, you know, really helps. Mm-hmm. And it, like, and yeah, you know, it's not me, you know, using the YouTube channel to bitch about my day or, you know, do any of that. But, you know, I do sometimes talk, if you go back to further episodes, I do sometimes talk about it. But more of like, okay, I'm going to put all this energy into creating a new thumbnail or, you know, trying to think of a new series or trying to, you know, do something for, you know, the vlogs that we do. You know, that's it. And it really does help. It really does help. Like, maybe I don't really, you know, particularly care for the job that I have now, but I'm grateful for it. Yeah, I have to drive an hour and a half. But, you know, when I get there, you know, it's like, oh, all right, well, it's just another day. And, you know, while I'm there, I'm thinking about the channel, like, what can I do? I'm writing down my little notebook. And it's great because now I have something that can distract from that. So it's not so bad. And again, like, you make a very good point about, you know, if you need to talk, and I know people don't like talking on the phone.
But, yeah,
you know, like, call a friend. Call a family member. You know, like, I talk about my mom all the time and how, you know, I make fun of how hard and like how, you know, like how she like puts me off. But if I had a problem, I could call my mother and she, even though she doesn't really get it, she would listen. And she would give, you know, her advice and tell me that she loves me. Even my friend Cassie, who is completely an emotional wall. She is the Berlin Wall of emotion. If you were to go up to her and said, I don't know how I'm doing right now, she'd be like, why are you feeling like, you know, it's like banging your head against a brick wall. But you know what? She'll sit there and listen to me. Like, I think there was like one time where I almost started crying in front of her, and I saw her immediately go, but you know what? I saw her grab the chair and she hung in there and she listened to me, and you know, I cried a little bit, and you know, after we were done, she was like, oh, that's fucking weird. And but you have things, and like a lot of people are like, well, I don't have any friends. I don't have anyone that can do that. Yes, you do. And you just probably don't even realize it.
Or you've already scared them all away. but anyways, like, I'm glad you agree with me on this point. It's just, it's like I said, it's just kind of annoying and almost like immature. But my point being, though, is like, you know, especially like for people that are in between jobs. And, you know, here's a word of advice. A lot of employers, or at least employers worth a shit, basically good jobs, they do thorough background checks, and one of the things that's on their checklist of things to do is go hunt you down on social media and see what you're posting. Yeah. So if you're smart, you have this stuff blocked, or you have your channel blocked outside.
You said it's private. Yeah.
And said it's private, right.
Because, you know, most companies now are really concerned about culture, and they don't want something negative that's brewing. Because, you know, if one thing changes in your life and you're willing to bitch about it, what's going to make them not think that, you know, if one thing changes at the job, you're going to go ahead and create a negative environment for their culture? That's it's a huge thing for companies now.
Yep.
It's like they love having an open culture, you know, and having, you know, no barriers between management and no barriers between employees. You know, they like that open door policy. And if you are spewing that, you know, you are a cesspool for poison, then they're not going to hire you.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yep. Because they're going to, especially, like, and you'd be surprised how many people don't have their shit set to private. Mm-hmm. And you just go and post and scroll throughout their whole 5, 7, 8 plus years on social media and kind of get into history. I mean, chances are most employers may not go back that far, but you never know. And just to kind of get a feel of how you are. And if all you post is negative garbage and you bitch about everything, whether it be customers, clients, coworkers, or even, you know, just everything in general, chances are they're not going to hire you. And not to say you're never going to get a job, but I mean, I guarantee you that if the company doesn't do thorough background checks like that, it's probably not that great of a company, and you're going to be right back smack dab in the middle of misery again. Yeah. So, you know, for the company that's worth a damn, be careful what you post on social media, because it is being viewed. And I don't even use Facebook that much. I check to see how my friends are doing. Mm-hmm. You know, occasionally post a new picture here and there, or if something eventful happened. I primarily actually use Facebook to set up events for me and my friends to get together, watch like the fights and other events like that. I love social media. I really do, because it got me, there's a video on my moto vlog where me and almost like 1,000 bikers got together with other moto vloggers, and we went on this ride to the Orlando Convention Center, and it was probably the biggest ride I think I've ever been on, and I had a great time. And I love social media for those aspects. But dial it back a little bit if all you can think about to post on social media is just bullshit and that's negative and almost borderline, like in the next like 3 days to 2 months, it's not going to matter. Don't post it, you know, but I'm always there to help somebody that's actually in need. You know, they just went through a breakup or their death in the family, or they are having a legit bad day and need just somebody to talk to. It's great. Just be mindful and tactful how you post that shit. Cause you know, nobody likes immaturity. At least I fucking don't. I think that's going to probably about wrap it up for this segment of our podcast. Sorry, I went a little bit over there. Just a good rant. Yeah, okay. I'll probably have an even more juicy one next week. So hopefully you guys like that. If you want to share your stories regarding other social media type fiends in your life, feel free to do so in the comments below. Or even if you'd like to see us talk about something else next week, let us know. Yeah. And if you like these, definitely drop a like and subscribe. Anything else you want to add, Sasha?
No.
All right.
No, we're good.
Well, cool, guys. You be safe, and we'll see you next week.
Yeah, see you, Dubs.
Bye.